In this video, I'm going to talk about the three major types of nuclear radiation, alpha, beta, and gamma, distinguished by how powerful they are, alpha being easier to block than beta, which is easier to block than gamma. There are quite a few videos about what these radiations are, but almost nothing about how we know what they are. For example, why was alpha and beta radiation discovered so much before gamma radiation? Or what did the discoveries of alpha, beta, and gamma radiation have to do with the discovery that a beam in a vacuum tube called cathode rays was really a beam of electrons? Why did it take so long to discover that alpha radiation was really a beam of helium nuclei? And why did it take even longer to discover that there's two kinds of beta radiation? Ready for the real, if slightly convoluted, story? Let's go!
Electricity.
Let's start in the summer of 1898, when a 27-year-old Cambridge grad student named Ernest Rutherford read a very interesting article in the science papers from Paris. A woman named Marie Sklodowska-Curie had used a very sensitive electricity meter to measure how radioactive uranium and thorium are. As Rutherford was just finishing his PhD on the electrical effects of X-rays, it seemed like a good idea to use Curie's method to study what was called Becquerel rays in the same way. Therefore, Rutherford took a scale and put a layer of uranium on a plate with a gap and measured the current from the electrified air. He then put a very thin layer of gold in the gap to see if and how the radiation changed. To his delight, the gold seemed to block some of the rays. Two leaves of gold lowered the current even more. Three pieces lowered the current too, but not by as much. When he switched to the thicker aluminum, after a few pieces, there was basically a steady current, no matter how much metal he added. Rutherford quickly realized that there must be at least two kinds of radiation, one that was easily blocked and one that wasn't, and decided to name them after the Greek letters for A and B, alpha and beta. On September 1st, 1898, Rutherford published his conclusion. Uranium radiation is complex, and there are present at least two distinct types of radiation. One that is readily absorbed, which will be termed for convenience the alpha radiation, and the other of more penetrative character, which will be termed the beta radiation. Rutherford missed that there's a third type of radiation because gamma rays are very hard to detect with electricity, and his uranium didn't produce much radiation in the first place. However, Rutherford did admit that, quote, "it is possible that other types of radiation, either of small intensity or very great penetrating power, may be present." Yep. Meanwhile, Marie Curie discovered a new highly radioactive substance in uranium ore that she named polonium after her native country of Poland. And her husband Pierre was so enthralled that he dropped his research to work with her on this new field. Then in December 1898, Marie and Pierre Curie published that there was a second substance hidden in the ore that was even more radioactive, so radioactive that they decided to name it radium. Radium was special. For example, it seemed to violate the laws of thermodynamics. It was always very hot and glowed bright enough to read by without changing shape or having any input energy source whatsoever. Now, everyone wanted a piece, but only the Curies in France and a German chemist named Friedrich Geisel, who had started working on it when he read about polonium, had any. And while they were working on it, they weren't sharing much except to their closest associates. Speaking of Geisel, in August 1899, some friends of Geisel, named Elster and Gittel, decided that since cathode rays, i.e. a beam of electrons, are easily moved by a magnet, it would be, quote, "interesting to determine whether the conductivity caused by the Becquerels, radioactivity, can also be altered by a magnetic force." They didn't notice anything from the weak uranium, but a piece of radium, on loan from Geisel, seemed to have a magnetic effect. This inspired Geisel and some other friends named Meyer and Schweidler to then wonder if the magnet actually slowed down the radiation from the radium or deflected some of the rays. They therefore decided to study the radiation from radium under a magnetic field with photographs. And by November 1899, they found that the radiation from radium was distinctly of two types, one that was undisturbed by magnetic fields and one that curved like cathode ray or a beam of electrons. Geisel and his friends also missed finding the gamma radiation because gamma radiation is hard to see with photographs. Yes, it's hard to see with electricity and photographs. That's why it took so long to find. Also, since alpha particles are very heavy, like 8,000 times as massive as beta, the magnetic fields used weren't strong enough to move the alpha particles much. And therefore, they thought the alpha particles that they were detecting were non-deviable. Inspired by the Germans, in January 1900, Pierre Curie set up an electrical system to quantitatively study the magnetic effect on radiation and validated that some of the radiation from radium was divertible with a magnet and some was not, and was also the first to determine that, quote, the deflected rays are the most penetrating. Therefore, in France and Germany, it seemed more descriptive to describe the two types of radiation as non-deviable instead of alpha and deviable instead of beta. 2 months later, in March of 1900, Marie and Pierre Curie reported that the deviable rays, i.e. the beta radiation, from radium contained negative charges and concluded that, quote, the deviable rays from radium, as with a beam of the cathode ray, carry electricity. This conclusion that the deviable rays from radium were like a beam of cathode rays were what aroused the interest of a shy chemist named Paul Villard and led him to discover the gamma ray. See, 3 years earlier, in 1897, Rutherford's advisor, J.J. Thomson, had determined that if he increased the vacuum for cathode ray tubes, he could get the cathode rays to move with electrically charged plates and not just by magnet. Previously, the trace amount of air in the cathode ray tube had acted like a Faraday cage and protected the beam from being moved electrically. Thomson then balanced the electrical force and the magnetic force and used this electromagnetic gauntlet to determine the speed of the beam. He then used the speed of the beam to determine the mass over the charge of the beam and found that the beam was made of teeny tiny negatively charged particles that were eventually called electrons. However, there was an experiment that seemed to invalidate Thomson's electron theory. When the cathode rays traveled through thin metal materials, they make it through the same electromagnetic gauntlet, which implied, if Thomson was correct, the cathode rays are little particles that tunnel through metal but keep the same speed, which seemed impossible. Villard, who was pro-electron theory, wondered if it could all work out, if the cathode ray didn't tunnel through the metal as much as cause the point of contact to be a new source of cathode rays. To validate his theory, Villard conducted a new experiment where he had part of a cathode ray hit an insulated sheet at an angle and found the beam was split in two, where the part of beam that hit the metal emerged perpendicular to the surface and ended up at a distance to the center. It was in the middle of these experiments with cathode rays that Villard read the Curie's paper about the deviable beams from the radium and how it was similar to cathode rays. He then wondered if these beams would act like a cathode ray if it hit a piece of metal. Luckily, Villard was working in the same building as Henri Becquerel, who had discovered radiation in the first place with uranium, and who had been supplied radium from the Curies. Villard then borrowed some radium from Becquerel and put the radium in a lead container with a small hole in it so that the radiation came out in the beam, and then had half the beam of radiation hit a metal sheet at 45 degrees. And recorded the response on a photographic plate that was wrapped in black paper, thus blocking out the alpha particles. He got a very strange result. He did get an image from some of the beam moving perpendicularly from the metal. However, a trace amount of the beam seemed to go straight through the thin metal sheet. It immediately became clear to Villard that there must be two types of radiation that can go through paper. One that acts like a cathode ray, i.e. a beam of electrons, and one that can travel straight through thin metal like an X-ray. Villard then wondered if both kinds of radiation could be moved with magnets. So he removed the metal in the middle and added a magnet. He then found two distinct beams on the photograph, one that was unmoved by the magnet and one that was moved a few centimeters. However, the unmoved beam could not be diminished even after going through several sheets of paper and an aluminum strip and even a thin piece of lead. After Villard pointed it out, other scientists validated Villard's discovery. However, most people were far more interested in alpha and beta radiation, and even Villard moved on to other subjects. Now we go back to Ernest Rutherford, Back in 1898, when Rutherford was publishing about alpha and beta radiation, he moved from England to Canada to be a professor at McGill University, which had what he called a swell lab, so that he could, quote, knock the shine out of the Yankees. In Canada, Rutherford started doing amazing work. For example, he discovered a new radioactive gas, and with that radioactive gas discovered the half-life of radiation. And with his good friend Frederick Soddy, Rutherford discovered that often radiation involves one element transforming into another element in an effect called transmutation. Soddy recalled, "I can remember quite well standing there transfixed as though stunned by the colossal import of the thing and blurting out, 'Rutherford, the thorium is disintegrating and transmuting itself into an argon gas.' Rutherford replied, 'For Mike's sake, Soddy, don't call it transmutation. They'll have our heads as alchemists.'" By the way, Rutherford and his friends discovered all this with radium so weak it couldn't even light up an X-ray screen. For example, for years, Rutherford was convinced that alpha radiation was made of charged particles, which means they should be moved by a magnet, but it was incredibly difficult to measure as they are so heavy and their radium was so weak and therefore produced so few alpha particles. In fact, it wasn't until February of 1903 when Rutherford was able to experimentally demonstrate that alpha particles from his weak radium were, quote, deviable by a strong magnetic and electric field. The deviation is in the opposite sense of the cathode rays, so the radiation must consist of positively charged bodies projected with great velocity. This was also the paper that Rutherford decided for the first time to name the third type of radiation, gamma rays, as gamma is the third letter in the Greek alphabet, and he wanted to start his paper with a short description of the three types of radiation. Marie Curie obviously read Rutherford's paper, because 4 months later, when she presented her PhD thesis, she not only included that Rutherford had found that alpha particles are movable by magnets, she also, for the first time, named the three types of radiation, quote, according to the notation adopted by Mr. Rutherford, by the letters alpha, beta, and gamma. Mere months after publishing her thesis, the Nobel Committee announced that Marie Curie was being awarded a fourth of the 1903 Nobel Prize for Physics. The public and the newspapers fell over themselves in excitement. Suddenly, everyone wanted to know about radium, and the Curie's thesis became the Bible of radioactive research. And the three types of radiation were referred to as alpha, beta, and gamma, as they've been referred to ever since. Let's take a moment and look at Marie Curie's phenomenal 1903 PhD thesis. In it, she said, "The alpha rays are very slightly penetrating, and the magnetic field acts very slightly upon them. The beta rays are less absorbable as a whole than the preceding ones. They are deflected by a magnetic field in the same manner as cathode rays. The gamma rays are penetrating rays, unaffected by magnetic field, and comparable to Rontgen rays, i.e. X-rays." These definitions are still considered correct today, and the only major thing she missed was that alpha particles are composed of helium nuclei. And to discuss that, we need to go back to Ernest Rutherford and his friend Frederick Soddy. See, about a month before Marie Curie defended her thesis, Frederick Soddy moved from Canada to England to work with a famous chemist named William Ramsay. Years later, Soddy recalled, quote, "Our trouble here was the same as in Montreal. We had quite insufficient amount of radiation for our investigation. Then, by most extraordinary chance, the whole future prospect was changed. What happened was, while going for a walk, Soddy casually happened to see a shop with pure radium from Professor Gesell in Germany on sale." A few weeks later, Rutherford visited, and Soddy wasted no time about telling him about the extraordinary find. Soddy recalled that Rutherford, quote, "was absolutely bowled over and became as excited as a schoolboy over the coming holidays. With 30 precious milligrams of pure radium bromide, we bounded back to the laboratory, and we both immediately repaired to the darkroom with some metal foils and a bit of X-ray screen. The effect was terrific. It was like a person born blind suddenly being given sight. For though Rutherford had made a special study of the Becquerel rays, this was the first time he had ever seen them. Now he had a visual demonstration of what he had found out in the dark, so to speak. Rutherford then kindly lent his 30 milligrams of radium to Soddy while he went on a European vacation. And while Rutherford was celebrating with the Curies after Madame Curie finished her PhD thesis, Soddy and Ramsey demonstrated with their two different radium samples that radium emanates helium gas. Rutherford, Soddy, and Ramsey were then fully convinced that alpha particles were really charged helium atoms, but it was incredibly difficult to prove it, even with their stronger radium. In fact, it took until November 1908 for Rutherford to conclusively prove that alpha particles are charged helium atoms, and that, quote, "the charge is twice the unit charge carried by the hydrogen atom set free in electrolysis of water." Just a few months after that, in mid-1909, Rutherford was asked by his co-worker named Heinz Geiger for a suggestion on a good, easy project for a new student. And Rutherford suggested that he could use some of his radium and, quote, "see if any alpha particles can be scattered through a large angle off a super thin piece of metal." Now, Rutherford just wanted to get the student used to the equipment, as he was convinced that alpha particles are way too heavy and energetic to be bounced off a thin metal. However, a few days later, he was shocked to learn that some of the alpha particles did bounce off a thin piece of metal. Rutherford thought about it for over a year and decided that, quote, "this scattering backwards must be the result of a single collision. And when I made the calculations, I saw it was impossible to get anything of that order of magnitude unless you took a system in which the greater part of the mass of the atom was concentrated in a minute nucleus." And thus the idea of the nucleus was born. With the idea of the nucleus, it became clear that the alpha particles were really helium nuclei. One comment about beta radiation. It turns out that the beta radiation that they were experimenting with was only one kind of beta radiation. See, in 1934, Marie and Pierre Curie's daughter Irene and her husband Frédéric Joliot conducted an experiment where they bombarded aluminum with alpha particles and found that the resulting material emanated radiation that was positive but had the weight of an electron. Now, the existence of a positive electron, or positron, had been discovered 2 years earlier in cosmic rays, but this was the first example of emission of positrons from radioactive decay. For this reason, beta radiation is usually split into two types: beta negative decay, the more common kind, where an electron is emitted, and the more rare beta positive decay, where a positron is emitted. And that is how alpha, beta, and gamma radiation was discovered and named, and how we know that alpha radiation is made of helium nuclei, beta is made of electrons or positrons, and gamma is composed of high-energy massless electromagnetic radiation. Now, to understand how radiation works in the nucleus, we need to talk about the neutron, which was discovered and named by, you guessed it, my friend Ernest Rutherford. And I'm going to talk about that very soon, I promise. But first, I want to talk about something else. I want to talk about helium. I was quite surprised to learn that the discovery of helium didn't predate the discovery of radiation by very much. In fact, helium was only discovered on Earth by Frederick Soddy's boss, William Ramsey, 3 years before Rutherford discovered alpha particles. Before that, it was just found in the sun, which is why it is named after the Greek god of the suns, Helios. But wait, how did they discover an element in the sun? How did Ramsey discover it on Earth? What does it have to do with Kansas and the tragedy of the Hindenburg? And how did it end up in party balloons? This fascinating history is next time on The Lightning Tamers. Thanks for watching, and thanks to my patrons for supporting me. If you want to be thanked too, there's a link down below. If you want to know more about Marie Curie, I have 2 videos about her. If you want to know more about Ernest Rutherford, which you do because he's awesome, I have 2 videos about him. If you want to know more about J.J. Thompson, the discovery of electrons, I have a video about him. I have a lot of videos. Spend all day, spend all week, watch all of them, why don't you? If you haven't yet, hit the subscribe button, hit the like button, hit the bell button, go crazy hitting buttons, and put a comment there, even if all your comment is saying, hi, how you doing? I'm doing okay. Okay, I hope you are doing okay too, and stay safe out there. Bye. Story? Let's go.